Thank you. precious gift of the one man, Jesus Christ, overflowing with the word of God. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Win that waiting game. But But the way it was set up, the carrying water from the Gihon spring through this small tunnel into the city, it took a long time. And of course, when a city's under siege, there's usually a larger population in it than normal, because there are people seeking protection. So King Hezekiah decided he was going to do something about this. And so he built a tunnel that goes from the Gihon spring and takes water into the city and dumps it out into the pool of Siloam. This was quite a project. Most of it had to be dug through bedrock using just picks and shovels. And he actually started two different sets of workers, one on this side and one on this side. And the entire Hezekiah's tunnel is about a fifth of a mile long. So they began work, and they finally met in the middle, and they were just an inch off. And I thought that was just amazing. 2,500-year-old technology, can you do that sort of thing? And of course, at that point in my life, I wasn't an engineer, so I was very fascinated by this, and by King Hezekiah, this great figure. So, one of the semesters of my seminary career was spent in Jerusalem. And I told myself, I'm going to be there 4 months. I'm going to find the time while I am there to walk through Hezekiah's tunnel. Probably have to find somebody who knows where it is, how to get in. But I'm going to do it. Because, for all I know, that would be the only time I'm in the Holy Land. And so I didn't want to miss out on this literally lifetime opportunity. But the thing is, I didn't know much about Hezekiah's tunnel since biblical times. Who knows? Maybe somebody connected a sewer into that estate. Or maybe there was some hole dug in the middle that I would fall into and never be heard from again. So I was afraid. It's pitch dark. It's all underground. Hard rock. And so I decided that I would try to entice my seminary brothers to come with me. And of course, nobody wants to look like a coward in front of his peers. So I got them to agree to come with me. And we did. We walked through the entire tunnel. The water was deathly cold. In some places, it was up to our ankles. In other places, it was over our necks. And we had to swim a little bit. And it was scary. We had flashlights in the water. But I could do it because people were with me. This is true of our lives. Having someone with us makes us feel a little more safe when there are things to fear. And that's what today's readings address. Facing fear with God's help. So, the Lord rescues and saves in Jeremiah. He hears the poor and answers their call in the psalm. He gives generously the gift of salvation, even though we are sinners, in Paul. And in Matthew, Jesus tells us, do not be afraid, because the Father is watching over you and taking care of you. There is nothing that happens in your life that God does not know about. Now, it even goes so far as to say that God knows how many hairs are on our heads. I don't even know how many hairs are on my head. Apparently God does. In our day, we seem to be very preoccupied with the self-esteem of individuals. Well, for a Christian, this is where our real self-worth comes from, or should come from. That God is concerned about our lives in their most mundane aspects. If God makes it his business to be aware of the smallest aspect of my life, including the numbers of hairs on my head, then I must be worth something. Something great indeed. Our self-worth comes from the fact that we are shown. children of God. And we get into trouble when we try to base our self-esteem on something else, like our accomplishments, for instance. Now, that's not to say that accomplishments are not good. No, God has given us certain talents, certain gifts, and throughout the course of our lives, it is incumbent upon us to use those talents and gifts to set goals, to attain those goals, to go through the work that gets to those goals. Those are good things. They give us confidence. They teach us new things. They uncover talents we may not have known. So that's a good thing. But the problem is when we try to use our accomplishments as the reason why I'm worth something. Right? For instance, I have a relative who is severely affected by what's it called when you got an extra chromosome? Down syndrome. She's never spoken a word in her life. She's probably in her 60s now. Setting goals, attaining goals, this is not part of her experience. Then it would be. And I'm sure there's some people alive today who would look at her and say, why did her parents not abort her? What does she have to offer to anyone, to the world? Why? Well, as a matter of fact, her parents, they were my great aunt and uncle, as I recall, because their last child was Down syndrome, it kicked them into gear about this whole issue. And they started taking in other kids who were in real need, like her. And in fact, they formed a community where these people took care of kids like this. That would be one good outcome of them having a Down syndrome child. But I'll bet there's a lot of things that she has brought into this world that only she could do because God created her with certain talents and gifts that we may not be able to discern them, but she's bringing something into the world. And do you know how I know that? Because she's alive. If God didn't want her to exist, she would not exist. But she does, and in ways that most people don't understand. She brings something into humanity and has something to offer the world. So, I would say in her case, she's a loved child of God just because she exists, but I would want to say that about everyone else too, even if you can't accomplish things. So, we are valuable in God's eyes. Jesus' claim is that he is with us, and so why should we fear? Why do we let fear rule so much of our lives? I'm guilty of that sometimes. I'm afraid of some situation that stands before me, and I shrink because of fear. I mean, that's what happens too. The person who fears much makes decisions about his or her life based on that fear. And the thing is, we're called sometimes to enter into some bad situations. We're called to raise our voice up against certain issues in life. Abortion, marriage, sexuality, family values. And if you do, you can expect ridicule, rejection, sometimes persecution. In some parts of the world, you can be killed for voicing your opinion. Well, the Lord says today, don't be afraid to speak the truth when that is needed. He says that everything that is not known to us right now, both the sins of the world and the grace-driven good things that have been done, will someday be known by everyone. Someday the truth will come out about all the good and bad that people have aligned themselves with. It will just be in plain sight. And then people will see whether we were ruled by our faith or by our fear or even by our indifference. Today, if you could look back 100 years or so to the people who spoke and acted against slavery. We see their courage. Some people call them prophets even. Abraham Lincoln, the abolitionists, and later on Martin Luther King Jr. These people were willing to pay the price for the truth, and they suffered because of it. They were very popular with a great many people of this nation. But they persevered. And in many cases, that was from God. Abraham Lincoln mentioned that a few times. Martin Luther King was a Baptist preacher. So the Lord is saying, don't be afraid to stand up for the truth. The Lord is with us every step of the way, even knowing how many hairs are on our heads. Such is His intimacy with us. And this is what should give us our self-esteem. That love is where we're called to draw our worth from. You know, it's interesting. Different prayer styles in the church focus on a person's breath, their breathing. Why? Because if you're alive, it means God wants you to be alive. And so, with every breath you take, you are fulfilling God's will. And remember that line from the last Psalm, Psalm 150. With every breath I take, the Lord's praise. The Lord's praise. So, this is something we have to think about in our own lives. When the Hezekiah's tunnel shows up in your life, and you need to walk through the door, you're going to kick yourself. I would, had I not done what I did. But I just helped. So do you. If what you're called to walk through is going to be hard and is a just thing that needs to be done, you can be sure the Lord is going to be with you. And you can psych yourself into it that way. Inviting Him, Lord, please be with me. I know that you'll be with me. Help me do this thing I need to do. That is the lesson of today's readings. Let us stand and together. I believe there should be one God, Father.
especially for us in this moment. Let us pray to the Lord. For the safety of missionaries throughout the world, as they work tirelessly to share the good news of all of our children.
Bless our dear Lord God of all creation. For through your goodness, we
Pray for those sisters that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Receive, O Lord, the sacrifice of reconciliation, and praise and grant that, cleansed by its action, we may make offering of a heart pleasing to you, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
This is our promise.
Lift up our hearts to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks. Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For through his paschal mystery, he accomplished the marvelous deed by which he has freed us from the yoke of sin and death, summoning us to the glory of being now called a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for your own possession, to proclaim everywhere your mighty works, for you have called us out of darkness into your own wonderful light. And so with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory as without end. We adore you. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Welcome them into the life of your faith. us all we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him, and with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Thank you.
is just amazing that you can both of them have a two-year community. So I'm going to come, please see me at the official and pay this for the thing. Last week, several of you read, considered, and signed a petition which I have for the formation of the health district here in South Park. Thank you. If you didn't, and you are a district board, you would be verified by Tom Jefferson, or the area is ordered by Kenosha Pass, Trout Creek Pass, Cruiser Pass, and Jackson Pass. Please see me on the mess or at the barbecue. Also, last week I failed to acknowledge that in Omaha there is one physician who practices 3 days a week. I apologize, but I'm overstayed, so I wrote things down today. Park County is a healthcare desert, so please do consider supporting efforts to establish a healthcare district and to reopen the clinic here in your life. Thank you.
Rip off the contact information on this white brochure. Okay, it is a nonprofit organization, so 100% of your donation is tax deductible, as well as on corporate. And I want to jump back on the father, just like father couldn't have gone into the caverns of Jerusalem without friends, not even maybe his mission. So I ask you to prayerfully consider supporting me. Filling out a card is not a financial obligation, it just means the worst thing that will happen is a phone call for me. And I look forward to meeting you and as a better support. Thank you, God bless.